Hello, everyone. Welcome to the first of two winter quarter housing webinars with University Residences. My name is Allie. I go by she, her pronouns, and I'm going to be your host this afternoon. I'm a Western alumna, class of 14, and I work in the admissions office here at Western Washington University. I also lived on campus my first year at Western. I lived in Edens North, which I loved so much because it's close to everything and it's hall style, which was so fun for me. I used to fire up my Nintendo 64, open my door, and people would just show up and play, sometimes with snacks. That's literally how I met my best friend of now 10 years. So I'm joined today by members of Residence Life, Housing Occupancy, Communication and Administrative Services, and Dining and Facilities. These folks are here to answer any of your questions, ranging from how to move in, the application process, to what campus might look like winter quarter. Before I begin introductions, please feel free to use the chat, like literally right now, to ask any questions you might have. We will address as many questions as we can in the next hour or so. With that, let's not waste any time and meet our panelists. For questions that we don't get to, we'll post answers asked today and their answers on the housing website, housing.ww.edu. All right, so let's start off by saying hi to our friends in Residence Life. Vicki Vanderwerf is our associate director. Vicki, would you please tell us what brought you to Western and the biggest lesson you've learned since you set foot on Western's campus?
Yeah, so I think what brought me to Western was a few different things. I would say our student population is amazing. Our students are phenomenal, really engaged, involved, really have a strong voice for equity and inclusion, which was something I really appreciated, and are just ready to learn leadership skills, develop leadership skills, and really seek strong academic interests. So that all of that really excited me to come to Western and work with our students here. The biggest lesson I've learned is that all of that is true, that equity inclusion is a strong value at Western and something that everybody really advocates for and really pursues. And that's something that's really important to me as well. So that's something I've really appreciated about being here.
Hey, thanks, Vicki. Up next, we have our residential assistant, better known as RA, Avery Garitano. Avery, same question over to you. What brought you to Western, and what's the biggest lesson you've learned since coming here?
What brought me to Western? Honestly, I came and toured over a summer. I toured the campus, and I honestly fell in love with it. It's a beautiful campus. It's a perfect size. I really wanted to live in the Pacific Northwest. I also think that there's a lot of really amazing programs. I'm currently in the Huxley College of the Environment, and I've met some amazing professors, had some awesome classes, and so really loving my decision. The biggest thing that I've learned since coming to Western is to not be afraid to reach out to people and ask questions. I know it's a little intimidating, especially coming to a new school, but I've made some really amazing connections talking to professors, talking to Res Life staff, and I don't think I would have gotten to where I am now without asking questions.
I wish I had learned that lesson in college. Thanks. Joshua Gaylord is our apartment advisor, also known as AA. Joshua, can you please tell our audience what the difference between RA and AA is?
Yeah, of course. And so a resident advisor typically is kind of like my job, but except they're in like the freshman dorms, like what you can traditionally imagine as a college experience. As an apartment advisor, I oversee and, you know, just like look after students in our Burnham Wood apartment complex, which is kind of like this transitional housing where students have like a kitchen and they're learning how to transition to like the adult world.
Awesome, thanks. And now would you please tell our friends what brought you to Western and the biggest lesson you've learned since coming to campus?
Ooh, well, Western was actually the only campus I got to tour. Like, I'm a first generation college student. I was like, if I can afford to go visit one place, it's gonna be Western. I'm from New York originally, and so wanting something different, but also like have that city familiarity, like Western really brought that to me. And also I felt like this was a place I could learn and explore, and the people were just really nice. The one thing I think I've learned since I've been on campus this entire time, like I'm a senior this year, so I'm gonna graduate, is that like you might fall in love with things that you never would have expected. And Western has a lot of opportunities for that. Like I never expected myself to be in a leadership role and doing what I do today, but I enjoy it. And there's just so many possibilities.
Sweet, thanks. So Terrence Simons is our Facilities Associate Director. Terrence, what brought you to Western and what have you learned since you got here? And you're muted, friend, I'm sorry.
What brought me to Western was I started my career off in 1990 as an Air Force officer, and so starting my career in public sector, and then spending many years in military, and then moving into private sector for 17 years. The funness of being in the military and is developing the troops and stuff. And for me, I wanted to finish my career by being involved at Western, because students are very similar to a lot of what I did in the military is they're there to learn, but they're there to enrich their experiences in college and stuff. And it was that attracted me to coming here, and along with the many facility things that need to be done at Western. Things I've learned is being the first higher ed place that I've been at is, there's a lot of things take a lot of time, but what enthused me is the students that work for me and the students on this campus. I feel very confident that the current generation is gonna move us and take us far into the future. Just seeing all the interactions I've done with the students, I'm very impressed, and that gives me a big kick, and I like that.
Me too. Our students are so cool. Jeremy Honey is our food service director for Viking Commons. So Jeremy, same question. What brought you here? And what have you learned during your time as food service director in the VC?
Thanks. Good evening, everyone. I came to Western about 14 years ago as a freshman. I was drawn to the area. The campus is beautiful. I fell in love with the website, and here I am, and I stay. The two biggest things I learned, you can never overorder chocolate milk, and there's no such thing as making too much mac and cheese. And that has remained the same for 14 years, and I don't see that changing anytime soon.
Jeremy, thank you. And last but not least, we have Kaimi Deerdorf, our occupancy specialist. Kaimi, what brought you to Western and to university residences in particular? And what have you learned since you got here?
Hi, everyone. What brought me to Western is I actually grew up in Bellingham and left to live in Seattle for quite some time. And I went to UW and worked at UW for a while. So when I moved back to Bellingham, the university was the obvious option for me to work. And I actually started out working in Woodring and moved to university residences in particular because I was able to work with students in a way that I wasn't able to work with students at Woodring. I was supporting faculty there. And our students are really pretty amazing here at Western. So I've been in this role for 13 years now. And so obviously I love it. And my biggest lesson, like I just said, our students are pretty amazing. They surprise me every year. I would also say one of the biggest lessons that I've learned is since this pandemic, it really strikes me how I really love working with students and working face-to-face with students. And, since not being able to do that has been our, reality for the last 6 months or so, that is one of the lessons that I am looking forward to getting back to, for sure.
Thanks. We're all definitely missing that one-on-one connection, especially with students. But let's start diving into the questions that y'all are asking in the chat. So, I'm going to pitch this one to Avery and Joshua first. What's it like being on campus right now? Are people going outside, meeting new people? What's it like?
I guess I can start out. It's fine. I'm not going to lie to you. It's definitely different. I know it seems kind of like a ghost town, and I'm one who loves people and loves like the whole like busing the class and seeing people around campus. And although that does seem like gone, it's like there's so much involvement like online And there's people that are still like willing to like engage. There's still people who are willing to like to meet, but you know, we still have to use things like Zoom and like, you know, like Discord and stuff like that. So there may not be a lot on the surface, but it's still alive and there's still stuff going on. I hope that answers your question.
To bounce off of what Joshua was saying, yes, it's completely different. You do have to adapt to having your school and your living space be very proximal. However, there are a lot of opportunities to be creative. I, for one, go and walk to coffee very often with residents, with people in the community, socially distance, of course, with masks, like we are still following all safety, but it's allowing me to get outside more. I feel like I've gotten outside a lot more than I have in previous years when I'm buckled down with classes and trying to get place to place. We also have a lot of community events still. A lot of them are online, but we try to make them accessible. For one, I work in Buchanan Towers and we have lounge space. So when we can, when restrictions are lifted, we like having small spaces where people can gather in person, socially distance, snacks. We do snack deliveries sometimes for events. It's adapting, but still fun, and there's still social elements. It's not like you're locked in your room.
Right on. Thanks for telling us all about that. Next question is going to be for Kaimi. Is there anything we can do if we missed the deadline for fall deferrals?
By fall deferrals, I assume you mean the winter status change form for your winter application. So students who deferred their application from fall to winter based on COVID guidelines, that sort of stuff, all those applications were active up until yesterday. And you needed to use the winter status change form in order to tell us that you actually still want to come for winter. If you didn't do that, go ahead and send us an email and we will absolutely activate your application for you.
Awesome, thanks for that. Hey Vicki, what are the move-in dates going to be? Some folks are asking about their parents trying to arrange time off of work to help them move in and things like that that takes a little bit of pre-planning.
Yeah, so our big move-in date for winter quarter is Sunday, January 3rd. Welcome to come at that time. All the halls will be open. Our staff will be back, ready to welcome you. So I would plan on Sunday, January 3rd.
Thank you very much. Next question is going to Terrence. Question is, are all of the campus buildings shut down for the next quarter? And if you'd unmute yourself, please.
On the residential side, all of our residence halls in the north and the south are open. Our residence halls on the ridge is not open. We've got the construction going on, and that's that space in the ridge is designated for specific purposes. Our dining halls in our south dining hall and our north dining hall is open, but the ridge dining hall is not open. And on an academic side, I think at this point in time, they're not open because everything's online, but you could probably speak better to the academic buildings.
Anyone else want to chime in on academic buildings, or what if I want to go to the gym or the library?
Yeah, so there are some in-person classes going on, recently changed. We've gone completely remote through the end of this quarter, but there has been academic classes happening throughout campus so far this quarter. And then other buildings on campus, the Viking Union is a big one that a lot of students want to see. It's closed currently, so it's possible that that will reopen for winter. I'm not exactly sure yet. That will just depend on where we head with COVID-19 and if our numbers go down a bit in the state of Washington. Other places like the library is closed, but they do offer some curbside pickup and a lot of electronic options to make sure that you get the resources that you need. The rec center is also closed, but the great thing about the rec center and some of our partners in housing is we're still planning events with them. So the Outdoor Center, the Rec Center, to do some in-person, small group, socially distant rec sports, fitness classes, hiking, biking. Last quarter, they offered some campus tours and socially distant bike tours, which was a lot of fun. So there's still a lot going on. We just have to adapt and like Avery was talking about, just do things a little bit differently. But there's all those things still happening, just in a different way. But a lot of those buildings, unfortunately, are closed, and we're not exactly sure what will open for the winter quarter, but should know that pretty soon here.
Thanks, everybody. Speaking of adapting and doing things a little bit differently, Jeremy, would you mind telling us a little bit more about how dining has been impacted by COVID restrictions?
Sure. So currently we are doing takeout only. We're using reusable to-go containers and then small compostable containers on the side. For most of this quarter, we were offering dine-in as well as an option. It was for a time multiple students per table, and then based on enhanced restrictions went back to one per table. We are currently at takeout only though. As Terrence said, we do have Viking Commons and Fairhaven Commons open. We do also have two convenience stores. We have the Haven Pod, and then we put together a pop-up convenience store in the entrance of Viking Commons as well. We don't have any other dining locations open. They're all inside buildings behind exterior doors, so we're not able to open those until those buildings themselves open back up.
Thank you. Next question is going to go over to Kaimi. Is it possible to join in the spring quarter if classes happen to go back to in-person? Folks are saying they didn't see that as an option on the housing dashboard, and they'd like to know how to do that.
Sure. Yeah, if you would like to come for spring rather than winter, and you've already canceled your winter application, all you have to do is reapply for spring quarter when that application opens up on January 15th. We did offer the option to defer your application automatically for fall, but because it's a smaller group this time, we're just going to have you reapply to let us know that you actually want to come for spring.
And Vicky, I know this is a really, really hard question that we're all having to deal with, but do you think classes for spring quarter are probably going to be online as well, or do you think we have a chance of being together in person?
Well, I can make a prediction. We don't know exactly what that will look like for winter quarter. That's really a university decision, not a housing decision, although housing has a lot of stake in that. I would say if I had to predict, that I would say we're probably going to be really similar to the fall quarter in terms of some classes being in person, like labs, any classes that need a significant in-person presence. But just with, we know there's news of a vaccine coming out, but, probably won't be available readily or to the public right away. And those types of things. And with our cases in Washington going up a bit over the last few weeks, my assumption is we'll be really very closely similar to fall 2020.
Thank you for busting out the magic eight ball there for that answer. We appreciate you. Couple of questions for Kaimi about dates, processes, and procedures here. So when will folks be assigned a building / room assignment? People are saying the website says late December. Mm-hmm.
So we actually can't assign until we know what spaces are open. And so students have until the end of the quarter to completely check out if they're leaving. So we'll process all of those checkouts after the last day of finals week. So we do that on the Monday and Tuesday following finals week. So assignments will be posted probably later that week. We're hopeful that they'll be done by Wednesday, if not by the end of that week. So that would be December 17th, 18th-ish is when those will be posted.
Gotcha. And so just to clarify, that might be a couple of days after the housing deposit is already due to be turned in.
It's always after the deposit is due, yes.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And one more question for you right now. Can folks change their dorm preferences in their housing applications?
Yes. Up until you pay the deposit, you can make changes to your application.
And is that pretty intuitive for how to do in there?
You just go back to the portal, click on apply for housing, and it will auto-populate your previous answers, change what you like, and resubmit.
Awesome. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Hey, Vicky, how are you folks deciding who lives on campus winter quarter?
Well, I might have Kaimi add on to this one too, but I would say in terms of who lives on campus, Kaimi will know better, so I'll let her correct me if I'm wrong, but we should have plenty of space for students who do want to live on campus. We're housing one person per room in winter quarter, similar to what we're doing in the fall. But we have many spaces that are still open. So I don't think we'll have to make the decision about who is able to live on campus, because I'm very confident we'll be able to house everybody who has an interest in doing that. But Kaimi, I'll let you either confirm or change that answer.
Sure. At this point, we will offer to everybody that has applied. Our application deadline is actually December 1st, the priority deadline. So we know that some applications will trickle in, but at this point we have space for everyone that's applied and has said that they still want housing for winter.
Awesome. Thanks. And one more for you, Kaimi. You can just leave that mic right on. Is there any period of time where folks can get their deposit back if they choose they don't want to move up to campus?
Sure. At this point, once you pay your deposit, it is forfeit if you then cancel. So you have until the 15th, December 15th, to pay the deposit. So you've got until then to decide. We haven't sent out offers yet, so there's nowhere to go log in and pay right now. That will be coming next week, so do be checking your email for that. But you've got until December 15th to make that decision.
Awesome. Thank you very much. And we've got another one for you, very popular today. You are the expert after all. So suppose someone has canceled their winter housing application and they would now like to uncancel that application. How can they go about doing that?
Go ahead and just send us an email and we will reactivate that application for you.
And where would you like that email to go to?
housing@wwu.edu.
Thank you very much. And if one of you don't mind popping that in the chat, that would be fantastic for everybody. Let's go back over to Vicki. So what's the capacity of rooms going to be during winter quarter? Someone is specifically asking about Burnham Wood, but we'd like to hear that for kind of everything too.
Sure. So all of our housing spaces have one student per room. So Burnham Wood, for example, there's two bedrooms in an apartment. They share a common space, so living area, living room, kitchen, bathroom. So there's two people in that apartment, one per bedroom. Similarly with our suites, a lot of our suites have two bedrooms that share a bathroom. There's one person in each of those rooms, so two people in a suite. And then in some of our community style buildings where there's a community bathroom, where several students share the same bathroom in a hallway, there's one student in each of those rooms. So one bedroom or one person per bedroom across all of campus.
Thank you very much. And we're gonna follow up with Kaimi on that question. So since the housing is single occupancy, how and when will folks know whether they are placed with the roommate of their choice if they are in a situation like Buchanan Towers where they have a suite mate?
Sure, we will try to place all roommate requests in suites together. So if you're requesting a specific roommate, we'll look for an open suite where we can assign the two of you into the same suite together. And that'll get posted when we post assignments.
So thank you very much. And over to Vicki. Are students required to get tested for COVID before coming to live on campus?
No, students are not required to get tested before coming to campus. We do encourage testing as much as possible if in your local area or if you live locally in Bellingham or close to Bellingham, we do encourage you to get tested. It's really easy here. It's a lot of the times it's free. It's drive up. You can get tested in just a few minutes and go. So if you have access to that in your local area, please do that before coming to campus. But we know that testing is not accessible across the state in some areas, and then also across the country out of state as well. So that's the reason that we don't require testing. However, when you do arrive right after your move-in day, the Student Health Center is starting testing again on January 4th. So we expect you to get tested right away after you move in. The next business day that after your move-in date, We want you to get over to Fraser Hall, it's one of their academic buildings on campus, and they'll test you for free right at Fraser. And we get those results back really quickly, within 24 to 48 hours. So we definitely want to have everybody tested, any new student, returning students, when they do get to campus, but it is not required before you move in.
Thank you. What else will the move-in process look like a little bit this winter quarter? You know, can I bring my family with me? All those sorts of details.
Yeah, good question. So it'll look similarly to the fall quarter, but if you're unsure about what that looks like, you're definitely able to bring your family with you. We do ask that you limit your guests to two. So two family members, two friends, and whoever you want to bring, who is over the age of 13. We ask that you socially distance yourselves. We'll have move-in times that you can sign up for. So we have a move-in application that you'll get over the next few weeks when we get a little bit closer to that January 3rd timeframe, and where you can sign up for a time to move in so not everybody's coming at once, so we can maintain social distancing and physical distancing. But you're definitely able to bring your family. They can stay, help you set up your room, make sure that you feel comfortable before they leave campus. We ask that nobody stays overnight. We're not allowing guests or visitors overnight. And we usually don't allow guests and visitors, but during that move-in time, we make that exception so you have some help moving in. But our staff will be there to greet you. There'll be folks that are there to answer questions, let you know where things are in the community. You can also ask our front desk staff as well if you have questions about where things are or what to do next or how to get different places on campus. So we'll be here to welcome you on that January 3rd move-in day.
Thank you very much, Vicki. Next question is going to go over to Terrence. So once we're already moved in and settled into our rooms, can you talk a little bit about the safety protocols in place for safety in the residence halls beyond day one?
Yeah, so I can talk about that. So as it relates to the all the common areas where you have the high touch points, the custodial teams are sanitizing doorknobs, elevator buttons, all those types of things at least three times a day, every day. When you get into the bathrooms, besides the daily clean that you have in these community bathrooms, that the same sanitization process kicks in. We've also got, there's a disinfectant and wipes in all the lounges, and the furniture in the public area lounges are set up so it's socially distanced. There's maps that identify where you can and where you cannot sit. So, it's a 24/7 operation as far as the disinfecting aspect of it.
Thank you. If anyone wants to Google WW Cribs, you can see a pretty cool YouTube video where you can see actually some of those things marked out during a really, really cool residence tour. But our next question is going back over to Kaimi. So if someone deferred their fall deposit to winter quarter, do they have to worry about doing anything with that deposit now?
We actually didn't defer any deposits from fall. We don't hold a deposit if you didn't arrive for fall quarter. We refunded it to your student account. So you should see that back when you canceled, you'll see that $200 credit on your student account. So we'll ask for a new deposit for anybody that's coming for winter.
It's good to know, thank you. And one more for you while we have you. Mm-hmm. Where exactly do folks request their roommates? Is it somewhere in my housing or do they need to do anything different with that?
They just need to send us an email. Typically we have the roommate request function in My Housing, but that's only for fall quarter. So for winter quarter, you would send an email, make sure that your friend that you're requesting also sends an email, and we will hold on to those until we assign, and hopefully we'll be able to pair y'all up.
Thank you. This one's for Terrence. We have a question about items that may have been put into storage lockers on campus. Is there a good time to set up the return of items that have been stored on campus?
I need some clarification on that. So is it items that have was put in place in fall, or Is it item? Is there a place where when I come up, I can store stuff in a spot? I don't understand the question.
We might be a little bit confused too. If the person who asked that wants to clarify in the chat, perhaps you were referring to the Res Hall reuse program. We'll work our way back to this, perhaps.
Okay.
Thank you very much, though. But for right now, let's talk to Joshua and Avery again. Can you both take turns talking a little bit about your experience as an RA or an AA on campus in the fall?
Yeah, I guess we can just go in this order. It's definitely been challenging because of COVID and wanting to keep everybody safe, but still trying to keep people engaged. I know something I've done personally is I'm always checking up on my residents. I send out newsletters with like fun facts or helpful tips to self-care. I know we pride ourselves on doing programming and events to try to get that engagement and get students to like mingle and meet each other. And the ways we've been doing that are just like simply drinking tea together over Zoom or doing a Bob Ross painting demonstration. And that's been pretty successful. And for those students who say can't afford art supplies, like, well, we get that with our budget and then we deliver it safely, disinfecting things. And that's been pretty successful. I know it's been a lot of online things, but as Avery said earlier, it's caused us to be creative and be innovative. And so we're still putting our all and creating that engagement regardless of the barriers.
Yeah, I guess I'll go next. Something that I've been doing is if I see a resident in the hall, I invite them to hang out and chat. I am always open to be social. I know a lot of people are looking for conversations too. It's a little harder to find that when people aren't out and about in the halls. I do host a weekly event with my suite mate who's also an RA. It's called Anime Wednesday. It's a little bit more niche, but we do it every Wednesday and we both stream online and we have reservable lounge spaces and we have prepackaged snacks and stuff. So we try to get that in-person engagement that's still safe. You still have to wear your mask, you still have to be distanced, but you're still in person, you can still talk and engage a little bit. Or if you're not comfortable with that, we have the online options too. I know that in the future, we're planning on doing possibly a virtual talent show, also game nights with Jackbox games. So we have lots of ideas. And something that is really cool in the community is that if you have ideas too, we are more than willing to like listen to it and give you the resources to make these happen if you work through the resident directors. So start brainstorming ideas. Like we are looking for socialization. Another thing, and this was student led too, we have a Discord server for the Buchanan Towers community where a lot of residents have coordinated movie nights and have coordinated walks downtown, which has been really cool in connecting people. There are a lot of people in that server, even like streaming online. I know I had one resident that would stream cooking and like teach people how to cook things and bake things. So there's still a community. It's different finding it, but nonetheless.
Thanks. I've personally been enjoying the DormCraft server and playing Among Us with students around campus. So all kinds of things going on right now. We have another roommate question for Kaimi. Someone says that they have received a confirmation from housing that they requested their roommate, but the roommate did not receive the same confirmation. Should they both send another email together? What should they do?
Depending on when you emailed, if it was just within the last couple of days, we've been getting a pretty high volume of emails and it does take us a little bit longer to respond to those. So I would say wait another day or two. And if you still don't get an email, then go ahead and both send us an email again.
Thanks for that clarification. Jeremy, someone would like us to expand a little bit more on the dining experience over fall quarter, specifically how do to-go options work?
Sure. When students move in, they receive a green to-go card voucher. When they come into the dining hall for the first time, they exchange that as part of their meal swipe for a green to-go box, and that's reusable. They can get as much as they want in that box, as well as a soup container, a salad container, desserts, pizza, a sandwich, and a piece of whole fruit. So every meal you can get a pretty giant stack of food, depending on what you want to eat. When you leave the dining hall, you take all that out. When you come back in, bring us your green box. Give you a brand new one, freshly cleaned. Same thing on the way out again. When we were doing dine-in, you had the option of dining in. If you do dine-in, you can't take anything out apart from a piece of fruit and dessert. And then we give you back one of those green to-go cards. That way, when you come back in, you can change it out for a box again. When students move in, they get the card along with a description about that program, how the card works, all the boxes they can get. And yeah, that's pretty much that. We have had a few cool events. I know it's hard to have them, but we've had Farm to Fork, where we feature local vendors, local farms. Last night we had Thanksgiving dinner. And then when we get back from Thanksgiving break, I think we have a couple more surprises in stock.
Right on, thank you. I'm really proud of how flexible and creative everyone's being around campus. We're gonna loop back to Terrence for that storage locker question. So someone had items put into dorm room movers storage lockers after leaving housing spring quarter. We're wondering about those things. Does that help a little bit?
Yeah, I saw Alex's comment, so I emailed Alex. So Alex will give me a call after our session's over, and I'll get him set up.
Awesome. Thank you. Making those one-on-one connections right here on Zoom. It's great. Love to see it. Back to Kaimi. So someone is having trouble choosing which building they would like to live in. Is there any way that we can talk a little bit about the buildings? Maybe we should bring Joshua and Avery in on this a little bit as well.
Sure. I would say typically for new incoming students, I would often recommend a corridor style building just because you tend to meet more people that way, although it is a different kind of a year. So there's, you know, all sorts of different things about each one of our buildings. We have 16 residence halls. Some of those aren't open right now. So we've only got North Campus and South Campus open. And I would suggest to go to the website, take a look at the photos. There's some all sorts of different information there. Oftentimes for a lot of folks, it comes down to bathroom style. So you can take a look at what the configurations of the rooms look like. There's floor plans on the website. And depending on what you're interested in, you're gonna have a great experience either way. Living on campus it's a good experience, even if it is a strange year. And I would say, yeah, Joshua and Avery, if you could chime in, that would be great.
Yeah, no, building off of what Kaimi said, like my first year at Western was in Mathis. And so you have the traditional like one bedroom for two people with a shared bathroom kind of community. And I met a lot of my closest friends there because like you're sharing common spaces, like there's no way to escape that interaction. And I really enjoy that. But also if you're looking to like live more independently, like say in Burnham Wood, we do have apartments. And so we have like kitchens, and there's also kitchens in Buchanan Towers. And so if you want to cook your own food, that's great. And in Burnham Wood, meal plans are optional. And so if you want like that adulty feeling, go for it. I know I really enjoy the space, and like I'm a taller guy too. So like the Burnham Wood showers are like my height, which is really great. But if that doesn't matter to you, that's fine. It's, yeah, it just depends on what you're going for. I know Burnham Wood traditionally tends to be more, you know, independent, as I said, like there's not much of like a lot of like engagement on the surface because people are kind of doing their own thing. And that's cool too, if that's your thing. But if you're looking for that engagement, as Kaimi said, I recommend going to like a dorm style or even Buchanan Towers.
Do also note that we do not allow freshmen in Burnham Wood. So if you're an incoming transfer student or a returning resident, off-campus student, you can definitely choose Burnham Wood, but Burnham Wood requires a waiver for incoming freshmen if you want to choose to live there.
If you are a freshman and are still wanting a kitchen though, we have quite a few freshmen in Buchanan Towers, which is a little unnatural, but that's COVID times. We do have a shared per suite. We have a kitchen and a bathroom, and you will likely have a suite mate. So if you're looking for that more personal social interaction while still having hall style, that's Buchanan Towers for you. I also have experience my freshman year. I lived in Edens North, and that is a hall style. So I met a lot of people. I was actually very close with my entire floor. And right connected to that building is Edens, Maine, and that building is suite style, but it's very beautiful. If you wanted to live anywhere on North Campus, Edens, Higginson, Mathis, Nash, those are all really close to downtown Bellingham. Also, if you're looking for proximity, it's a really quick walk, a really nice walk to get there. And if you are looking more South Campus, like Fairhaven or Buchanan Towers, you can also walk to Fairhaven, which is really nice, like downtown Fairhaven. And Fairhaven itself stack style. You have like kind of like a group of suites together. So a little more than meeting just people in Buchanan Towers, where you just have separate suites in a hall.
And the only thing I would add to that too is to check out our programs in each of the communities. So we have Pride Housing for GLBTQ plus students, gender neutral housing. We have a sustainable food program over in Fairhaven. There's substance free living communities. So there's a lot of different options in each of our halls to check out on the website as well.
And just to add to that, I am the RA for Pride Housing, and I live on the Pride floor in Buchanan Towers, so I definitely vouch for that if that is something you're interested in.
Thanks, everybody. One of my favorite things about talking to students about housing is that pretty much everybody thinks that the dorm that they lived in is the best residence hall on campus. It's really great. So obviously, Edens North, best dorm. Back over to Kaimi for another portal-type question. So someone selected that they were interested in housing on their housing portal. What should be the next step after that?
So next we will send out housing offers. So you get an email next week that asks you to go ahead and pay that housing deposit. The deposit is going to be due by December 15th. So like I said earlier, take your time. Think about if you want to come, you do forfeit that deposit if you pay it and then cancel later. So go ahead and get that paid by December 15th. Then we'll assign directly after that, and then you'll move in.
Awesome, thank you. While we have you, we've got a clarification question about Edens Hall for a minute here. Is it true that all of Edens Hall, not Edens North, but Edens Hall is reserved for students in the honors program? And also, is it true that it's full?
It is true that it is reserved for the honors program, and it is mostly full right now. So we have a few spaces that are available in Edens Hall, and also students who are in the honors program live in Edens North. So students that would like to live with the other honors students and that are part of that program, they'll be assigned to both Edens and Edens North.
Thank you very much. All right, we're going to do a roundtable question here. I'd like everyone to let our audience know if there's just like one thing you would like them to really carry with them about winter housing. What are we missing? What's the one nugget of wisdom you want to impart on our audience here? Let's start with Terrence. Sorry to put you on the spot like that.
One thing we like to impart. If you're not from Western, if you're not from Washington State, it's cold. Who knows if it's going to be snowy and a lot of snow. We've kind of had pretty mild winters, but combination of that and just the COVID climate. Bellingham's a nice place, even though it's rainy and stuff. And the people here are the students you have here and the staff you have here are going to be as accommodative to you, and it's a very warm place, even in a wintry environment. So that's what I got to say.
Thank you very much. And let's move on to Jeremy. What would you like to let everybody know?
Probably that if you are hoping for a specific thing to be open, right now dining is looking like it's going to be exactly the same for next quarter. So Viking Commons, Fairhaven Commons, and 2 convenience stores.
Thanks. How about you, Avery?
I would say if you can, separate your school place and your school workplace from your living space. If you're able to go to a lounge and do your homework there, that is so good for your mental health, and it allows for some more normalcy, feeling like you're in your class space and then you're in your home space. We have lounges that are open as long as you wear your mask. And you could also, once places open downtown again, there are some places that still have like coffee places like Makeworth that have like in-person dining. And so if you're able to do that, I highly encourage it.
Thank you. How about you, Kaimi? What do you think?
I would say that even though it is a different kind of a year and living on campus may look different, your experience is going to be what you make of it. And that's always how it is on campus. I've heard from some folks that they're having a harder time connecting. I've heard from the majority of folks that I've talked to that as long as you reach out, you're going to make some connections. I talked to a dad from Hawaii the other day who was gushing because his son was having the best time of his life living in Higginson. So it really is what you make of it. And we're excited to have you come to campus.
Thank you. Joshua, what do you think? Would you like to tell folks?
Yeah, it's definitely been a learning curve for a lot of us, but coming into next quarter with the experience that we have now and what we've learned, I think your RAs, including me, if I get the pleasure of being your AA, we have stuff prepared and we are like, hey, like we can do this better. And like, we're already thinking about new exciting ways to engage people, like new events and better ways to reach out. And so you'll be coming at the forefront of that. And that's exciting.
That is exciting. Thank you. And Vicki, final word to you. What would you like to leave us all with today?
I would say Western is really focused on our students and really student-centered. So housing is no different in that. So we're, like Jaime said, really welcome or ready to welcome you, want to welcome you, answer any questions that you have, support you while you're here. Avery and Joshua are two amazing staff members, and we have others as well throughout all of our communities, as well as our resident directors who live in the building. Who work in the building to really be a resource for you, help you in your transition here, any academic questions, refer you to campus resources if you need any help while you're here too. So please reach out, don't hesitate to contact us. We are really excited to have the opportunity to serve you, so encourage you to utilize those resources as you can.
Thank you very much. And that is going to wrap up our first of two winter housing webinars for today. I want to thank all of our wonderful panelists. We appreciate you all so much for sharing your expertise with us. Shout out to Liam, Dune, and Chaya in the chat for making this happen. And of course, a huge thank you to everyone who hung out with us today. We really appreciate you for joining us. Don't forget, we're going to have questions and answers posted on housing.ww.edu. You can also stay in touch with all of our housing friends on Instagram at wwhousing, or you can check out a little bit of student life at Western at ourwestern. One more shameless plug for our Snapchat account. You can talk to me anytime, day or night, at WWAdmissions on Snapchat. Thank you again, everybody. We are so happy that you joined us, and have a wonderful evening.